we are, at the Brighton and Sussex Neighbourhood School. Let's go, have a look around. Behind me is the infamous school office. Students line up right here on deadline day to hand in work. You can feel a sense of tension and stress these anxious poor kids go through. The carpet is seemingly soaked from the tears and sweat from yesterday's deadline. And a hint of urine. Shocking, shocking scenes. Some of the faculty have agreed to talk to me. For their own safety, we've agreed to withhold their identities. So do you set a large amount of coursework for your students?
Not really, but we're making great answers about you.
So how would you explain such a large amount of paperwork I saw around your office?
Well, we're making them in two black and white copies, three colour, one lots of photocopier, and a sound of silence, two A1 CP copies. There's two very good reasons for this. Firstly, we make a good profit on printing. And secondly, it's very nice to watch your stock so much.
A second-year student just entered the office. It looks like he's complaining about the software in the lecture theatre.
Hi, sorry, I'm not very good with these things. Could you come help us with the Camtasia?
I thought it was about to kick off, so I got out of there. We're now here at the Phase 2 offices. Things in Phase 2 apparently get a bit more hardcore. From my research, one of the hardest parts of Phase 2 is filling out the logbook. How do you guys decide what's reasonable to ask of the students?
Good question. Again, in the student office, as I'm sure you can tell, we get quite bored. One of our brilliant time fillers is revamping the logbook, adding in some more unusual sign-offs, and amending the handbook, ensuring timetables are a little more confusing than necessary.
Can you give some examples?
Yeah. In terms of timetable, there's the classics, such as scheduling four students to go to a clinic, but the consultant has requested only one attends. It's fancy to move the fight.
And the logbooks?
Well, for the first time this year, we've introduced the must-witness two cardiac arrests sign. We're already hearing reports of students hovering around with frail patients on the outing board, and even another student using an air horn to frighten patients. Of course, this contributes to ever-present drive to increase business of student support, and students may at last rights to have decent reflectors.
Again, quite revealing. Let's move on to the Phase 3 school office, where we deal with those just months away from becoming real doctors.
To be honest, Ross, I have an easy job at making their lives difficult. They're all so busy, while with finals approaching, that all we have to do is put their placements that little bit further away, just to kill off the last end, whatever social life they may still have retained.
Why do that?
Well, we've learned from personal statements that students like to travel, so we like to put them pretty far away. A personal favourite of mine is a month in finger reduction surgery in Norfolk, and we make most of them commute.
Join us next week as we lift the blinds and delve into the tissue-filled depths that is student support. Do the dyslexics really need their perks? Does that girl really need her Ritalin? Are they very upset after the loss of their pet hamster to Luna? Join us next week on Ross Kemp to find out.